Hi, welcome to the first session of Investment Philosophies. In the next 25, 30, 35 sessions, I'm not quite sure how many, I'd like to go through what I think of as the central theme in investing, which is to have an investment philosophy that actually works. Having said that though, let me back up. When I first started thinking about investing, I noticed two things. One is there aren't that many great investors, right? I mean, you can name them. The second is, if you look across great investors, they actually range the spectrum. Peter Lynch was a great investor, and he was a growth investor. Warren Buffett is a great investor. He's a value investor. In fact, there are some investors who've looked at charts and have been great investors, which led me to the thinking that led to this book and this series of sessions. I'm going to argue that you can be successful with a variety of investment philosophies, as long as A, you've chosen a philosophy that fundamentally works, and second, you've chosen a philosophy that best fits your characteristics as an investor. Notice how I framed that. The best investment philosophy for you is not the one that works for Warren Buffett, but the one that works for you. So with that introduction, let me lay the table for what I mean by an investment philosophy. An investment philosophy is a way of thinking about markets. It's a way of thinking about how they work and how they don't work, because ultimately, if you want to make money, it's based on market mistakes. An investment philosophy is not a strategy. So if I ask you what investment philosophy is, and you tell me it's to invest in low PE stocks, I'm going to say no, that's not an investment philosophy, that's an investment strategy. So an investment philosophy is far broader than a strategy. It's a way of thinking about markets. So if you think about why you need an investment philosophy, the reason is very simple. If you do not have an investment philosophy, and lots of investors don't, including most portfolio managers, here's what I think will happen to you. First, you're going to be easy prey for anybody trying to sell you that crystal ball, a magic bullet. You've heard them, right? Just do this and you're going to make a ton of money. If you don't have an investment philosophy, you're going to get swayed by the next great salesperson who comes by, telling you that he has an investment strategy that works. Second, if you don't have an investment philosophy, you're going to tend to chase whatever worked last year. So you're going to pick the strategy that worked last year and you're going to try it. Then next year, you're going to try something else. The year after, you're going to try something else. You're saying, what's wrong with trying different things? Well, there are costs. In fact, the more strategies you try, the less chance there is any of these strategies will work for you. And you're going to end up with a ton of transactions costs and perhaps a very happy brokerage account. Because those are the people who will make money, not you. Finally, if you don't have an investment philosophy, you're often going to pick something, a strategy, that doesn't fit you. So I think you need an investment philosophy to be a successful investor. So let's think about different kinds of philosophies. And to set the table again, I'm going to look at the investment process as I see it. The investment process always starts with the investor. So if you're managing your own money, it starts with you. If you're managing somebody else's money, it starts with that somebody. In particular, I'd like to know what your risk preferences are. Are you risk averse? How risk averse are you? What is your time horizon? Are you short term or long term? And don't tell me off the top that you're long term because it might be out of your control. And third, what kind of tax status do you have? Do you pay a high tax rate or a low tax rate? And the answer to that question might vary depending on which part of your portfolio you look at or when I look at you. So the key factors that drive the first step in the process is understanding the tax code and understanding the investor. Then starts the portfolio management job. The first step in portfolio management or creating a portfolio is asset allocation. Deciding how much of your money you put in broad asset classes. Broadly speaking, you can have stocks, you can have bonds, you can have real assets. Within each of these, within stocks, you can have global stocks. I mean, your domestic stocks and foreign stocks. With bonds, you can have corporate bonds, you can have treasury bonds, you can have high yield bonds. With real assets, you can have real estate, you can have gold, and a variety of other real assets. So the first step in portfolio management is deciding that asset allocation mix. And we'll talk about what drives that, but it's going to depend as much upon your risk aversion as it does on your views about the market, on macro variables. So asset allocation is often a macro judgment. Then comes the micro judgment. You've decided to put half your money in stocks. Which stocks are you going to buy? Now, you could pick your stocks based on charts, and I'm not going to predispose myself to saying it's not going to work, because for some people, it clearly does. You could pick stocks based on their growth potential. You could be a growth investor. You could pick stocks that pay high cash flows. You could be a value investor. Or you could pick stocks on something else. In effect, there, what you're trying to do is bring something to the table that will allow you to pick the best stocks, the best bonds, the best real assets. And we all try. So you've allocated your assets, you pick the right securities within each asset. Last step is execution. You actually have to go out and buy those assets. You think, what's the big deal? That should be easy to do. For some assets, that's absolutely true. You decide to buy IBM, it's a no-brainer. You can easily do it at a low cost. But if you decide to invest in real estate, it might be a little more involved. So there you have to consider the trade-off. Often the trade-off is if you want to trade something quickly, you have to accept higher costs. Now you're saying, well, I'll go for the lowest cost. Depending on your strategy, you might have to decide what trade-off works for you. Asset allocation, security selection, execution. Then after you're done, your portfolio goes into play, it starts to make returns. At some point in the process, whether you like it or not, you have to look back at your portfolio and ask yourself, did I make a sufficient return? Not just did I make money, but did I make a sufficient return given the risk I took on? So you have to measure the risk on your portfolio. You have to measure the return on your portfolio. You have to have some kind of benchmark that you decide that you have to beat. And you have to decide to be honest with yourself. Did I actually make money with all of this work I put into this portfolio management process? In fact, the reason I set the table this way is you can categorize investment philosophies very broadly on the following dimensions. Your investment philosophy can be a market timing philosophy, where much of your work is done at the asset allocation stage, or it can be an asset selection philosophy, where you believe that you can't time markets, but you can pick the right stocks, or the right bonds, or the right real assets. It can be activist investing or passive investing. This is not the same thing as active and passive investing. Activist investing, you actually take a position in an asset or a company, and you try to change the value of the company. Most of us don't have that much power, but if you have enough money, you might try to do that. With passive investing, you invest in the best investments you can and hope and pray that those investments go up as much as you thought they would. And finally, investment philosophies can be short-term, medium-term, or long-term. And there's, again, no predisposition on my part to say long-term philosophies are better than short-term philosophies. If you can find a short-term philosophy that works for you, all the more power to you. So in context, here's where the different investment philosophies fit in the big picture. Market timing philosophies go into the asset allocation stage. So if you're a great market timer, you can tell me which markets are going to go up the most. Whether it's the stock market or the bond market or the real estate market, if you're really good at it, you don't have to pick stocks or bonds, real estate, particular real estate, because you just have to put your money in the right asset class and you're going to make money. It could also be that you're very good at timing markets across countries, in which case you could move your money out of the countries where you think stocks are not going to do well into countries where they're going to do well. But those are market timing strategies. If you have asset selection strategies, basically you're looking at a variety of different philosophies. It could range the spectrum. You could pick stocks based on astrological signs. Again, all the more power to you if you can make it work. You can pick stocks based on charts. You can pick stocks based on fundamentals. You can pick stocks based on growth. Whatever you're doing, you're essentially trying to still pick the best stocks or the stocks that will make the highest returns within that particular asset class. And finally, you have execution-based philosophies, where essentially you try to take advantage of market mistakes. Classic example of this is arbitrage-based strategies, where essentially you try to find the same asset priced differently in two different markets. I mean, so what chance do I have of doing that? Well, no harm looking, right? And if you do find the same asset priced lower in one market and higher in another, it's easy to make money. Just buy it in the lower price market, sell it in the higher price market, claim the difference. There's also a fairly touchy area that I'm going to call information trading, where essentially you try to get ahead of the market and get information that's not embedded in the price. The only problem is in some countries, that information might be regarded as illegal to use. In the US, for instance, that would, of course, fall under the category of insider information. But that doesn't stop us from trying. So you can think of philosophies in terms of where they fit into that big picture of how we set together portfolios. So let's think about how we go about developing an investment philosophy. I think the first step is to lay the foundation. To lay the foundation, you need to be able to understand risk and incorporate risk into your decision making. I'm not talking about just understanding risk and return models in finance. You might never use them, but you might still be able to understand risk. Second, you need to understand financial statements. You cannot invest in stocks without understanding basic accounting statements. And third, you have to understand the process of trading. What are the costs of trading? What are the frictions? Why might your strategy not work in the real world? Second step, develop a point of view about how markets work and where they might break down. Markets make mistakes, or maybe they don't. If you believe markets don't make mistakes, your investment philosophy might become a very simple one. Just invest in index funds and move on. But if you believe markets make mistakes, you have to start fleshing out what types of mistakes they make and why they make those mistakes. And then find the philosophy that best fits you. That's the key. Best fits you. In what sense? Look at your risk aversion. Look at your time horizon. Look at your tax status. I'm going to give you a very quick snapshot of each of these. In terms of risk preferences, let's start by stating what's absolutely true. We're all risk averse. The only difference is degrees of risk aversion. So you have to decide for yourself how risk averse you are. And there are a couple of very simple ways you can arrive at that measure, but you need to make that judgment first. So if you decide you don't like to take very much risk, your investment philosophy has to be tailored to that. And guess what? Your returns are going to be lower. If you want to make really high returns, I have some bad news for you. You have to be willing to take risk. Second, you have to think about ways of evaluating risk. You can either take quantitative measures, and we'll go through a few, or maybe even qualitative measures of risk. But you cannot do investing without confronting risk face to face. Second issue is time horizon. I think we're all trained to believe that if you don't have a long time horizon, you're a bad investor. So when you ask investors, what's your time horizon? Most of them tend to say, my time horizon is really long. But it might not be within your control. Here are the two things that drive your time horizon. One is your personal characteristics as an individual matter. Some of us are more patient than others and are therefore better attuned to long time horizons. Some of us are more impatient. You make an impatient investor have a long time horizon investment strategy, you're almost guaranteeing that that strategy will not work because that investor will not have the patience to hang in there. So look at yourself. Be honest with yourself. Are you a patient person? Are you impatient? It also depends on how much you need cash. You could be a very patient person, but if your needs for cash are high, why? Because you're older, you're sicker, your kids have to go to college, whatever the reason, your time horizon automatically shrinks. So you tell me your time horizon, it's going to affect what kind of investment philosophy I pick for you. Because if you have a long time horizon, there are certain kinds of assets I can invest in, which I would not invest in if you have a short time horizon. So the longer the time horizon of an investor, generally speaking, the more risk you can afford to take because you have time as an ally to average things out. Last piece of the puzzle, we have to worry about taxes. Taxes are a mess. Taxes are a mess because the tax code is so large and so complicated. So when I ask you as an investor, how do taxes affect you? Your answer might depend on what part of the portfolio I look at. So when I look at your pension fund, I might get one answer. But when I look at your savings, I might get a different answer. Ultimately, though, you can invest and you can spend only after-tax returns. So you ultimately care about maximizing your after-tax returns given the risk you want to take. So different parts of your portfolio might be taxed at different levels. So dividends might be taxed at a different rate than capital gains, and those laws have gone back and forth. You might have different tax rates, as I said, on different portions of your savings. And the tax rate itself and the tax code changes over time. And you have to keep these balls in the air. You have to keep them juggling to get the best investment philosophy for you. So let me wrap up. To be a successful investor, you need an investment philosophy. An investment philosophy is a way of thinking about markets, about thinking about how they work and how they don't work. And the investment philosophy that's right for you will depend on how risk averse you are, what your time horizon is, and what your tax status is. So in the coming sessions, we're going to look at a series of different investment philosophies. And over as we look at them, try to think of which philosophy best fits you. But before we do that, we lay the groundwork. We'll think about risk, we'll think about value, we'll think about financial statements, and then we'll start talking about investment philosophies. Thank you very much for listening.